Starting from this video, we will look at recurrent neural networks, RNNs, which is the 10th topic of deep learning. This video is part one, providing the basics of RNNs and their data structures. This video was produced in Korean and translated into English. My voice is generated by AI, text-to-speech. Let's look at the full table of contents. In Chapter 1, we will look at Simple RNN, the basic model of recurrent neural networks. RNN is an artificial neural network that is useful for analyzing time series data. Let's look at why traditional feedforward networks are not suitable for analyzing time series data and why RNNs are needed. Next, we will look at how to construct a dataset for an RNN. The data structure for RNNs is slightly different from that of traditional feedforward networks. Next, let's look at the basic structure of RNNs. RNNs can be structured in many different ways. There are many-to-one structure and many-to-many structure, etc. Next, let's look at backpropagation in recurrent neural networks. The vanishing gradient problem occurs more seriously in recurrent neural networks than in traditional feedforward networks. Let's look at the reason why. Finally, let's implement a simple RNN model in code. Let's implement it from scratch using Keras dense layer. And let's implement it using Keras' simple RNN library. The Keras library makes it very easy to implement recurrent neural networks. In Chapter 2, we will look at long short-term memory, LSTM, which was designed to solve the vanishing gradient problem of simple RNN. First, let's look at the paper that proposed LSTM. And let's look at the structure of LSTM. Next, let's look at the backpropagation in LSTM. Let's look at the differences from existing RNNs and see how the vanishing gradient problem is reduced. Finally, let's implement the LSTM model. It can also be easily implemented using Keras' library. In order to better understand how LSTM works, let's implement it from scratch using Keras' dense layer. In Chapter 3, we will look at variations of LSTM. First, let's look at peephole LSTM. Let's take a look at the architecture of peephole LSTM and implement it from scratch using Keras dense layer. And let's look at the gated recurrent unit, GRU. Let's take a look at the architecture of GRU and implement it from scratch using Keras dense layer. In Chapter 4, we will implement different types of recurrent neural networks one by one. Let's look at the structure of a multi-layer recurrent neural network and implement it. And let's look at the structure of unidirectional and bidirectional recurrent neural networks and implement them. Now, let's take a quick look at time series data and recurrent neural networks. Data, where the past and present are dependent on each other, such as time series, cannot be analyzed with a feedforward network. A new model is required. This is the recurrent neural networks, RNN, that are widely used in time series forecasting, natural language processing, etc. Let's consider the following training data. There are two features, X1 and X2. These are data indices. So far, we've been using these feedforward networks to learn from this data. If the data points are independent, it makes sense to use this feedforward neural network. If XT and XT plus 1 are independent of each other, we can use a feedforward network to perform classification or regression. You can also perform row subsampling or randomly shuffle the data points. Let's use this data to create a scatter plot as we've done so far. Since we have two features, we can plot the data points in a two-dimensional space of x1 and x2. This figure appears to have no pattern at all. But if we plot these data points this way, we can see a clear pattern emerging. The x-axis is for the data indices, i.e. the time axis, and the y-axis is for feature values of x1 and x2. These are time series data. The blue chart is the time series of x1, and the orange chart is the time series of x2. These are sine curves of different frequencies mixed with Gaussian noise. The past and present values are correlated. In other words, each has autocorrelation. Fitting a feedforward neural network to this data is not appropriate. We need a new model to learn from this data. This is the recurrent neural networks. Recurrent neural networks are very useful for learning time series data. Recurrent neural networks are also widely used in natural language processing. This is because natural language data is also a time series composed of sequences of words. Recurrent neural networks can be used not only for time series prediction, but also for classification and regression. In this data, XT and XT plus 1 are dependent. The current values of a time series can be explained based on previous values. If so, future values of a time series can be predicted based on present values. This is time series forecasting. Again, these feed-forward networks cannot learn from the time series data. This is because feed-forward networks assume that the input data points are independent. Time series data cannot be sampled or shuffled because the dependency relationship would be broken. Here's a simple drawing of a recurrent neural network model for time series forecasting. Features X1 and X2 are fed into this model. This is a network that outputs XT plus 1 when XT is input. That is, this is a model that outputs present data when past data is input. Once this model is successfully trained, when you input present data, it will output future data that has not yet been observed. The output of the hidden layer is HT. HT is then fed back into the input layer. This is recurrent. When the next data point XT plus 1 is entered, both XT plus 1 and HT are entered together. Then XT plus 2 will be output. HT is past information, and XT plus 1 is present information. That is, the present and the past are connected. This is a simple recurrent neural network model. Next, let's look at the structure of a dataset that will be used in the recurrent neural network. We cannot just feed this data straight into a recurrent neural network. We need to transform this data into something that fits into a recurrent neural network. Again, these are time series, and the present and the past are dependent. However, we cannot learn dependencies that extend infinitely far into the past. Therefore, we need to limit the period of time for learning dependencies. In this example, the time step size is set to 5. The first subset consists of 5 data points numbered 1 to 5. This is the first subset, X1. The superscript is the subset number. and the second subset consists of 5 data points numbered 2 to 6. The second subset can also be created by skipping one space with 5 data items from data point number 3 to 7, like this. In this example, we slide the window down one step in this way to generate a lot of subsets. These are the subsets of features. Next, we generate the target data. For time series prediction, we set the next data point of the last data point in a subset as the target data. The first target is the 6th data point. The second target is the 7th data point. These subsets are input to RNN, and the targets are desired output. Now we merge these subsets into a single data structure like this. The original data has a two-dimensional structure, but this data has a three-dimensional structure. The first dimension is the number of subsets, which is the batch size that will be fed into the RNN. The second dimension is the number of time steps, i.e. the number of sequences. And the third dimension is the number of features. Targets are also merged in this way. In this example, the merged target is a two-dimensional structure. The first dimension is the number of subsets, i.e. the batch size. And the second dimension is the number of RNN outputs. In order to predict the time series of each feature, it becomes the number of features. The target can also be a three-dimensional structure, depending on the type of RNN. We will look at this case later. When the first subset is fed into the RNN, we want it to output the first row of the target. And when the second subset is input, the second row of the target is output. A series of data points within a subset are dependent on each other. Therefore, we cannot randomly sample or shuffle these sequential data points. This is because the dependency relationship will be broken. However, the subsets are independent of each other, so we can randomly sample or shuffle the subsets. Finally, let's look at how the dataset we generated on the previous page is fed into a recurrent neural network. The dataset is as follows. Let's assign a superscript to each data point. For example, this is the second feature value of the third time step of the first subset. We denote it like this. The subscript is the feature number. The first superscript is the subset number, and the second is the time step number. And we have this recurrent neural network. Like a feedforward network, it has an input layer, a hidden layer, and an output layer. Although not shown in the figure, there are biases connected to the hidden and output layers. Let's say that each layer has 2 neurons. But the hidden layer is a recurrent layer. The recurrence occurs 5 times, which is the number of time steps. The weights between the input layer and the recurrent layer are Wx. The Wx is I by J matrix. I is the number of neurons in the input layer, and J is the number of neurons in the recurrent layer. The weights between the recurrent layer and the output layer are Wo. WO by K matrix. K is the number of neurons in the output layer. The weights of the recurrent layer are WH. The WH is A by J matrix. To make it easier to understand, let's unfold this recurrent neural network as shown in the figure on the right. Time step T is from 1 to 5. Now let's feed the above data into this recurrent neural network. Data points in the first subset are fed into the input layer at each time step. We feed the data points in the first row of the first subset into the first time step of the recurrent neural network. Then we feed the data points in the second row into the second time step. And the data points from the next subset are fed into the input layer at each time step. This is a batch data. The outputs of the recurrent layer of the first time step are fed into the second time step like this. At the next time step, the outputs of the recurrent layer are also fed into the next time step. In this way, the outputs of each step are propagated to the last time step. This way, all the past information will be available in the final time step. In other words, it learns the dependencies of time series in a subset. At the first time step, the initial values 0 are fed since there are no previous recurrent outputs. The outputs of the recurrent layer at the last time step are fed into the output layer. And then we compute the loss using the outputs of the output layer and the target data. In this figure, the orange weights are WH. And the blue weights are WX. Not every time step has its own WH. There's only one WH. Each time step shares one WH. The same goes for WX. This can be expressed simply as follows. We will use this expression from now on. So far, we've looked at an overview of RNNs and how to structure a dataset for RNNs. In the next video, we will look at the basic types of RNNs and backpropagation.